The president of LIBE committee, Mr. Claude Moraes, is here with me today in the European Parliament. Thank you so much, Mr. Moraes, for your presence.
Hello.
I know it's important to discuss about this issue, very sensitive, as we all may see. It's the international child abduction and, of course, all the things that are connected to this situation. What are the discussions in your committee now?
Well, these were very important discussions last week in Strasbourg, in the plenary, and they centre around something which the European Union can do something about, which is the rights of children in international divorce proceedings. Why are we doing this? We're doing this because the numbers of child abductions, the numbers of international divorces, divorces which are happening across borders, are increasing exponentially, they're increasing rapidly. And because of this, the European Union needs to do something about it. We noticed this over the last months and years, that there was an acceleration in these kinds of abductions. And these abductions are happening because divorces are happening amongst couples who are travelling more, who are living in different countries in the European Union more.
Due to the free movement of people?
Absolutely. Free movement has spawned a kind of new way of living. And that new way of living, that independence, that way of working in more than one country is really putting a burden on children. It's putting a burden on those couples. People are having to work in this way, but they're also living in this way. And what the European Union is saying is that we need to work and to help where we have a role. And we absolutely have a role where there is a cross-border issue. And what we found in abductions of children, of course, but also in the proceedings on divorce, was that the EU is the natural partner. So, for example, we're trying to simplify the proceedings of divorce. But we're also trying to make the proceedings child-centred. What does that mean? It means bringing well-trained judges into the process. At the moment, you don't have this. We have very, very uneven kind of reassurances for children. We have people who are not qualified, really, in some member states dealing with these very sensitive proceedings. So the debate last week focused the European Union on making this whole proceeding a lot more stringent, professional and focused.
I've seen also that is a debate regarding the right of the child to express an opinion. Of course, we are talking here about children who have a certain age in order to be asked for an opinion. What do you think should be done here? Is it good to leave the opinion to the child, or is it too much pressure for the child?
As a lawyer, I find this quite controversial. I find it a very sensitive issue. In some cases, a child is not able to express themselves. And I want viewers to know that the European Union, the Parliament, did not in any way try to say that a child has to make the presentation or representation. What we were saying last week, what the European Union is saying, is that the child at the moment is not really at the centre of these proceedings at all. So the European Union is trying to bring the child more into the centre and to make some representations. But the default position, the most common position, will be the child will be represented by someone, by a professional legal representative, by the parents. But there will be more instances where a child who is competent, who can be seen to be expressing an opinion, can express an opinion. But this will be more exceptional. This will not be always the rule. But if we don't do this, I think what is happening in cross-border disputes and in an abduction is that the child's voice is really very much absent. But people should not get the wrong idea. We're not trying to make children always be the voice, because this is inappropriate for very young children, very inappropriate for children who are distressed. Instead, what we're trying to do is give the rules and the atmosphere so that they can make an opinion. For example, we're trying to professionalise the judges, ensure that you have judges of a certain standard. This is not always the case in member states. Family law is very different in member states. And as a lawyer, I know that there's a need now to have a better professionalisation in this area.
So it will be, it will be the appanage of a member state to focus on the child. On which member state, I will ask you, when we are talking about international cases?
Yes, so when we're talking about international cases, the emphasis will be on the national member state to improve its training of judges, its representation, but there will be European Union rules. Of course, the emphasis will be on the voluntary situation first, because we're not trying to impose on legal systems too greatly. But I think the overall idea is that where there are weaker systems, we want to try and raise the level. But I don't want people to feel that we are trying to impose on any country or create expense. No, this is not the case. This is a win-win situation. What is happening in the European Union is that these divorces or abductions are happening between countries. This is not something where we're saying, pointing to individual countries and saying, you're not good enough. This is not like this. This is about helping countries in cross-border situations. In the end, it's about helping children. It's helping vulnerable partners in disputes. If you ask me, where are things going wrong? Things are going wrong in that these disputes were given a very low priority. Now they must be given a higher priority, because we see the statistics are very troubling.
Also, the return of the child in case of a decision is a complicated process. Do you think that something should be changed in this area also?
Yes, there was a lot of discussion last week about standardising the returns process. Quite a lot of the rules we're hoping to change on returns. Because at the moment, there is a complication between countries. Returns can be very much delayed. Sometimes returns don't happen of the child. And this is because of blockages in the legal system. So last week, much of the emphasis was on how you can have legal, safe and speedy return of an abducted child. But remember, this is a legal process. When a child is returned, it is a very sensitive issue. But we must have rules which are standardised so that we know that the correct decision is being made. As you can imagine, this is a very sensitive area.
Of course.
At the moment, what we do know, because this has been studied very carefully, my committee is very heavily involved in criminal and civil law. We are the committee completely competent in this area, 100%, and we know that we would not embark on this having not studied it for many years. What we feel now is that we have reached a tipping point where if we don't act now, the number of abductions, the number of divorce proceedings across member states, which are ending in very bad situations. If I give you examples, they can end in domestic violence. They can end in very bad property settlements, poverty, bankruptcies. I mean, all of these things can happen. We want European citizens to enjoy their free movement. We want European citizens to feel free movement means something. What is happening now is that international divorce, disputes over children, is now becoming a barrier. We don't want this to happen. We want to grasp the nettle and to make sure that however difficult it is, Europe helps, it does not hinder. Many people will be thinking, how do you make it easier for a child to be returned? The answer to this question is it's never going to be easy. The question is you can standardise the process better, and then it's up to the judges, well-trained judges, good judges, to try and make the decision. At the moment, the problem is that the legal systems are so different. You have conflict of laws, so you have unnatural delays, and this makes families suffer. And particularly, if I may say, for children, for women particularly, I have to say, are suffering in these processes.
As a conclusion, do you think the problem is in the norms or is in applying the norms?
I think application is definitely an issue, but there are problems with norms also. I think application, because we have an unprecedented new situation, you really pointed to it very skillfully at the beginning. The European Union is a developing project, and one of the most astonishing developments is free movement. And free movement has been a success story, but with it comes real dramatic changes. And this is one of those hidden dramatic changes, that family life has changed. And divisions and family divorces, children being those who suffer because of it, has been one of the problems with it. So I think this also, freedoms of families, women being more independent, escaping domestic violence, for example. Many developments in society have happened over those years. And the European Union should not judge those norms. We should not be in judgment. What we should be is to enable life to be better, not to judge people's behaviour. This is not for the European Union. The European Union should just make the rules easier and to try and help people in difficulty.